comment. I'll tell you, many members of our community throughout the process took advantage of that. And I would also add that it was more than just comment, it was also an opportunity to answer questions that were raised by members of the public. Just to highlight three key considerations in developing this plan. As a former landfill site, it is a well-documented procedure of making any changes to what is a closed landfill. Those processes for reusing that site are prescribed, and we've worked with the Hampshire Department of Environmental Services, making them aware throughout this process that the community was thinking of making a policy statement, such as through the adoption of this plan tonight, of changing the current configuration of the parcel in some ways to promote public recreation and access. I can tell you, staff level, those have been extraordinarily well-received conversations. There are examples of other landfill uses in New Hampshire which are much more intensive than we're going to be describing today's plan to this site. But we do want to make sure that when we go into the implementation phase, if this report is adopted, the staff will continue to work with DES on the formal steps needed to ensure that we can maintain the integrity of the cap and do any additional work that might be needed to protect the site. Our conversations with DES have indicated that we are on the right track and that this will be, we'll have a very cooperative partner try and make this happen when we get into implementation. Next key consideration is the stewardship and promotion of passive recreation assets. They're really, this parcel has the opportunity, as improved, when access is more obvious to members of the public, it will really join a number of passive recreation assets that have been added in recent years, including the privately held creek farm trails, the nearby city-owned trail system at the Little Harbor, off of Little Harbor Road at that parcel, in addition to the Sagamore Creek headlands. The committee had many discussions, as have also been observed with the Conservation Commission, that we really added to a great resource set of passive recreation sites. And that was very important for a number of reasons. Number one, the committee wanted to find ways that we could manage those and promote those. And by also having a network of places where people can walk, where people can bird watch, where people can ride bikes, where people can picnic, you prevent against overuse of any one site. That was very important, because that we heard that from members of the public, concern about overuse, changing the character through too much use. This plan, the committee feels, does not do that. Certainly not in the context of the other places and spaces available for that type of activity. Then I also wanted to mention how this plan that I'll speak in more detail about in the coming slides is really intended to identify general uses. This is not a final design plan. We didn't spend a lot of our time talking about exact placement of amenities. We didn't have the skill sets in the room for that. We talked about general uses and locations in order to make this well utilized as a public recreational asset. And therefore, those details aren't there about what would be located, or what would be this material. So, the recommended master plan. It might surprise you, based on the amount of information provided so far, that the number of new uses proposed as part of this site is not extensive. What we are talking about is making a site that is publicly accessible, signing appropriately, inviting people to it, and making sure the amenities that are in place are managed in a way that protect the environment, and where we have informal access, informal use of a site, that we create formal access. So for example, the walking trails that are well utilized and in place, they are proposed to remain and continue to be used. Those include the cross-country trails. They'll be used by cross-country, both now and in the future. Right now, there is informal access to that open field space. As you saw, it's through a fence surrounded by chain link. This would promote formal access to the open field, returning the site to a more natural state, achieving that goal of preserving, even enhancing the site's character. We also have informal and unsafe parking area. I'll show a picture where the current configuration of parking is frankly haphazard. It is not conducive to residents who go to that site and have even logical access for parking. We are promoting a formal way of getting vehicular access to the site that is safe, makes sense, and ensures that the assets at the site are accessible to all of our people, and not just the people who are able to negotiate around the fence and walk a long distance to that open cap. We're also talking about access to the waterfront, which we have now. We're talking about formalizing access to the waterfront so that as people are introduced to the waterfront, they are walking on the same boardwalk to prevent degradation of the trails, walking in the same designated space to prevent damage to the habitat along the shoreline. That is what is promoted as part of this plan. Then finally, additional amenities include siding the space so people are welcomed to it, adding waterfront views and an accessible trail system on top of the cap. Currently, there is not a trail system on top of the cap. We think a trail system will promote use of that valuable resource, get people closer to that elevated view of Sagamore Creek. And then finally, interpretive markers are envisioned. There's many educational opportunities at the site, both for the natural resources as well as other cultural historic elements. Here is the first picture of the ninth of the master plan for Sagamore Creek. It's quite simple. I'll provide an overview right now, and then I'll provide some details of some of the specific elements. Here is the 66-acre parcel. Here's the access I've spoken about as it exists now off of Jones Avenue. Of course, the landfill cap is here. The mature wooded area and the other wooded area, which is more wet. The trail system, existing trail system with the thin green lines that continues to be shown. As you can see, the cap, we have the addition of a trail system along it to promote people to be able to get out on the cap. Also, we have the introduction of the removal of the fence at the front end here, permitting people to travel on the existing paved surface into the site at a location, a turnaround, if you will, at the cap end, where there would be accessible parking spaces. People would be able to exit through the same way. There's also, as part of this plan, an intent, something we would work with DES on, to remove sections of this, the fence that currently surrounds the landfill cap. That's an effort to open the site up, make it more inviting, and return it to a more natural state. We've been highly encouraged by DES so far on those types of details. Other elements of this plan include creating a formal waterfront access. This is so we can direct traffic so that people stay on a designated trail and not create their own paths to the waterfront, potentially creating problems from an environmental perspective. And there are also opportunities to improve the trail system, for example, with drainage or boardwalks, so that we're encouraging people to stay on the trail during rain events, again, as a matter of environmental protection. These next few slides show pages from the report, which is available at the website for Sagamore Creek, at link to at cityportsmouth.com. But this gives up. We worked hard as a committee in order to communicate to the public the types of investments, the types of modest improvements that are recommended as part of this plan, figuring that the images could help communicate. So here we have the signage that is introduced at Pierce Island. Very simple signage you might see at a state park or another natural area. That's envisioned as part of this plan. A kiosk area for communicating messages, perhaps messages to people who are organizing volunteer cleanups to remove invasive species or other activities that might take place at the site. And that kiosk is envisioned to be in that parking area. And the signage is envisioned to be, of course, at the Jones Avenue site, but also where we have great pedestrian connections to abutting parcels here, near the Route 1 corridor, as well as the high school. This next slide is about improving the existing pedestrian linkages, and this is primarily associated with where we can, making clear that people accessing from off-site know that it is a public space. That includes one particular area where the tidal inlet runs in that could be boardwalk in order to promote visitation to the site. And that area is located right here. Next is just a detail about the on-site parking, which I explained in the larger picture of the master plan. Here's the picture of the existing parking situation where it really is catch as catch can when residents visit there. And here's a detail of that. Close up of the turnaround parking area. So travel lane that exists into the site but is fenced off. This is envisioned where we would have the parking that is scattered at the Jones Avenue intersection here. It's envisioned to be parallel to one side. We have done dimensions on that. That is possible. We need to do final design, but it is possible. Then we get to a detail here on the access to the cap. This was a major initiative, thinking that the cap was underutilized and members of the public would appreciate having access to that large open space. And in addition, because not all the trails can be made accessible in the other locations, you may have an opportunity here to do a true accessible trail on top of that cap. With some proper engineering. The waterfront access, this is a detail. I particularly want to show these two images down here. This is the type, minimal, modest development that's proposed in order to facilitate this type of use. Waterfront decking, those two pictures are from the Rachel Carson Wildlife Refuge in Maine. Then we have interpretive signage. There's lots of opportunities for education, including about how we have, as a community, dealt with our waste over the years. We also have opportunities, as was suggested by one resident, to talk about our native populations, interpreting the presence of native populations in our area, as well as the information about vernal pools and other aspects of the natural resources. We have, at many of our recreation facilities, toilet facilities. There's an opportunity that was recommended as part of this report. We'll be evaluated during the implementation stage to introduce a composting toilet as an educational opportunity, also in keeping with how other governments have managed natural areas of this sort. Just a word about implementation. When in the past, when the council has identified a vision, a goal, such as represented in this master plan tonight, it's been up to the city staff, the city manager, it's usually through the capital improvement plan process, to designate funds and then make progress over time with investments to realize the vision. And prioritization would need to be done there, the sequencing would need to be done, but all at the staff level that would take place if the council adopted this plan. In addition, conservation funds would be available for this use and have been identified in previous capital improvement plans for this particular site. We anticipate that many volunteers, such as those already working at the level of the Conservation Commission and others who want to do trail maintenance, invasive species management, would be welcome to help the city implement and manage this site. And also coordination with boards that continue to have an interest in the parcel, especially the Conservation Commission. Mayor, that concludes my presentation this evening, and respond for action under the city manager's name.
Thank you, David. Thank you very much. Questions from councilors? And Councilor Thorson first.
Thank you. I was wondering if you could speak a little bit about the concerns over the condition of the cap and that it might have some issues with it. Has it been thoroughly checked to make sure that it is, has not degraded? Related to that is are any of the toxins that are under the cap leaching out in any of the areas? Is this a public safety issue? I think we need to talk about that. We had talked about the possibility of this area being open 24/7. That raises issues of lighting and that sort of thing, and safety. That area has seen a high incidence of vagrancy and drug use. And so then the question is, how do we ensure the safety of this proposal? And if we can answer some of those questions, I would appreciate it. Thank you.
And could I also, just a couple of comments, but I think maybe the best thing for us is to have our comments and have suggestions after the public comments, so we can get people to speak first, and then we can have a conversation. So if everyone else says okay? Thank you.
So we'll wait until
after
when it's on John's name, and
it might be useful after the public comment session, just to say we have some people that are here for that particular item can hear the council deliberation.
That's everyone. So we're going to move on with the agenda. The next thing on the agenda is acceptance of minutes for November 5th, 2015, and November 16th, 2015.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor say aye, please.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Thank you very much. Next public comment session, with the number of speakers that we have, I will allow each speaker to have 1.5 minutes. At 1 minute, the city attorney will hold up a sign that says you have 30 seconds, and 1.5 minutes, and that's because we have so many speakers, and we do have a rule to follow public commentary for 45 minutes. I will also allow Portsmouth residents to speak first, and then call on the several residents that are not from the city. So with that, I will call first to the podium and ask that you identify your name and your address. Rick Horowitz. Rick here. Okay, then I'll move on. Next speaker, please, is George Rebick. If I see Rick enter the room, I'm going to call on him later.
George Rebick, 1247 South Street, Portsmouth, New Hampshire. We're here tonight to possibly on naming the park for the Dr. Paul and Carolyn Harvey. And then back in the 90s, mid-90s, we formed the Lafayette Park Neighborhood Association. For many years, we fought on keeping the park as it is and a playground. Both Mr. and Mrs. Harvey were very involved in the Lafayette Park Neighborhood Association, and whose vision it was to keep the area as a park and playground for children and a place where people go to have a sense of community. And at that time, Dr. Paul was just finishing up. As you know, Dr. Harvey served many years on the school board. Carolyn was very busy with the Chase home for many, many years. And a lot of people here to talk tonight, and I think most everybody here knows what the Harveys have done. Assistant Mayor Swain will also be covering us up later tonight, and I just saw that come up. And I would say that as city manager at one time in 2001 also said it was a great public-private partnership which we did here, and we split the money. So it was $45,000 on the city and $45,000 from the neighborhood to put that together, and that $45,000 from the neighborhood was raised pretty fast with Mr. Dr. Harvey. So thank you very much, and I hope that you would. And you have plenty of they have all signatures up there, all the petitions are in. Thank you.
Thank you, George, very much. Next speaker, please, Rick Horowitz.
Rick Horowitz, 127 Gate Street. Thank you, Mayor Lister and members of City Council. I spoke at the last, or two city councils.